Welcome to HeartMind-ify. Before we start the show, just a reminder to share, rate, and subscribe to this podcast wherever you're listening to it. And please give us a 5-star rating. It helps us beat the big tech algorithms.
I'm John Izzy. Change can be difficult for a lot of us, but when we understand what makes us tick, we develop a better understanding of who we are and begin a journey of discovering our best self. Join me for a free session at johnizzy.com.
And I'm Kim Cordy, creator of the Emotion Chef Framework, an emotion management tool. Thoughts drive emotions, and emotions drive thoughts, but it's our emotions that drive our decisions and behaviors. Find out more at kimcordy.com.
Sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. Knowing each other personally and socially for the past 10 years, Kim and John have joined forces, bringing years of experience and training, providing a platform for growth and personal development, along with a little humor. John is the heart, Kim is the mind, and together they are HeartMind-ify. Well, hello, Kim. As I look out my window, the 10 inches of snow is beginning to melt. Actually, it's melting a lot, which is great. But now they're calling for a horrible storm on Sunday. So hopefully the European model is wrong and we just get rain or something other than this horrible snow that we're experiencing here on the East Coast. Yeah. How are you?
We're good. We're kind of making it a habit to give the weather report because you and I have such extreme opposite weather patterns. We are still dry. We had a little bit of rain, but it's gorgeous outside. I mean, absolutely gorgeous. The sun is shining. It feels like a spring day, which isn't good, but it sure is pretty.
44 days left. I ask Alexa every morning, Alexa, when's the first day of spring? And she tells me.
Yeah. I think you're going to have to be a snowbird eventually.
I know.
Every year you get grumpier and grumpier comes cold weather.
I hate it. Well, you know, the things I like to do, right, are all summer activities or spring activities. Like I haven't ridden my motorcycle in, well, my arm too, so that's another issue. But usually I don't ride the motorcycle in, you know, January, February because it's really cold. Unless we're going on a kid's visit with Baca, then I do ride. But other than that, I don't ride it and I get stir crazy because I love that time. So it's great. But anyway.
I've said it a million times, California has its downfalls, but you can't beat the weather.
Nope.
It is amazing. And as Andrew and I think about retiring and relocating, and it's like, where are we going to get this weather? We're so spoiled.
That's so funny.
So what's going on with you?
Well, you know, have you ever seen those videos where somebody goes out into the street and they ask people random questions of things they should know, right? They'll ask questions like, who's on the Susan B. Anthony coin, right? And they go, Lincoln, right? It drives
me. Who's buried in Grant's tomb?
Exactly. They'll ask these random people these questions, and then they'll ask them a topic, and they'll start to talk about a topic, and they get stuck. And I always wonder, what's the reason why you're getting stuck? Is it because there's a lack of critical thinking, or are you just going along with what your group of believers believe and there is no thinking on your part? So it's been driving me a little crazy lately because I'm reading things and listening to things, and it's almost as if people just take things for granted or they're too lazy to do any critical thinking. And that's kind of harsh to say, right? Because people do read. But my point is, when is critical thinking important? Because it's, to me, it seems like it should be important all the time, right? Like, I just don't want to live my life taking things for granted. or because someone else said to.
Yeah, I get that. And it's funny that you're bringing this up because there was a video. Was it a video or an article? An article in Apple News. Mm-hmm. And it was this, it was a combo article and video. It was this woman who had been part of QAnon. She lives in South Carolina and was just a rabid believer. And she was just sure that Trump was going to come in and there was going to be like
martial law,
the rapture, the political rapture. And all of these, seriously, all of these politicians and Hollywood movie stars were all going to be taken to Guantanamo Bay, which they were told had been closed, but Trump was going to reopen it. Yes. And she was just devastated. I mean, devastated. And she talked about her, the anger and the emotion that she had in the process of learning about QAnon and getting all this information from Facebook and TikTok and how it impacted her relationship with her daughter. And she was actually mean to her daughter. And my husband's like, well, what kind of, you know, thinking, what was she doing thinking this stuff? And I said, you don't understand. I said, when you are raised to always believe what you're told or you trust a source, so you're always supposed to trust a source, like a friend, like she got a lot of this from friends. So mm-hmm. you believe them, like they're telling you the truth. I said, when I was raised, you didn't have critical thinking in the religion that I was raised in at all. And you believed you not only believed, but you believed everything. Because if you didn't believe everything, you were an apostate. And I said, it's a mindset. And that it wasn't until I left that I really gained critical thinking skills. And it took challenging what I thought and what I believed and what was true for me, what was untrue. And that's why I'm such an avid, people always say, oh, you're always going on Google. My sister would tease, look at her, ask her a question. She goes on Google. And it's because I want to understand not from one source, but from multiple sources where I can get my biggest chance for truth.
So that's interesting that you mentioned religion, because if you think about religion and you think about the early church, and I'm talking 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th century, right? People didn't mm-hmm. read. People didn't have access to scriptures the way that we have access to them now. So they heard from the pulpits about God and the stories about religion. And they took that at face value and they never questioned it because they had no reference point. But today we have a reference point. And that's why I think that we have so many different opposing opinions when it comes to religion that probably didn't exist. Well, it didn't exist back in the, you know, 8th, 9th, 10th century because there was only one train of thought, right? So, or two major. So I think that once things come available to us and we have the ability to read on our own and to interpret things the way that we believe and the way that our life is structured, we come up with different opinions. But what I'm hearing in this article that you spoke about, she had all of those things available to her. And she freely chose not to look outside of what this group was saying. That's scary, right? It's like she was able to critically think. She was able to look things up and read, and she freely chose not to. So the impact of video, the impact of the voice, right, had such a huge impact on her that she didn't even go to books or she didn't even go to articles. And I think she even said she didn't even listen to the news because she was told it was fake, 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 fake. So that to me is even more worrisome when the periodicals, periodicals, when the reference books, I know, right? When the reference books.
You are old.
Right? That's hilarious. When the reference books are there, when there's multiple news sources there, and you avoid it, that to me seems a little bit, that's dangerous. That's really dangerous.
It's extremely dangerous. And the part about this that just, it saddens me, because people are making, I'm just going to say it because I say it all day, every day, not all day, every day, but you know what I'm saying? Not that I think I'm exaggerating now, but thoughts drive emotions and emotions drive thoughts, but it's our emotions that drive our decisions and behaviors. When we are so passionate about something that we can't step back and look at it rationally, that's a good time to say, hey, I probably am making a decision here based on feelings. And guess what? Feelings aren't facts.
So we talk about that a lot, right? Take 10 minutes a day to kind of go through your day and look at things, you know, meditate, give yourself some time on a walk, do some exercising. And it's easy for us to say that, right? Because I know I do that and I know you do that. So it's easy for us to do that and to say that because it's something that's a part of us. But how does somebody like this lady in the article break when her emotions are so high that she can't see anything beyond what she's being told? How do you find a time to take 10 minutes, right? How do you find a time to exercise? How do you find a time to take a walk in the park? That's really difficult. So how did she do it? How did she come out of it?
Well, she was forced to, because what they said was going to happen didn't happen. And she was devastated. Right. She was crying on the phone. She was thinking of taking her child out of school because she thought that there was going to be riots, that they were going to come after her. I mean, it was amazing how distraught this woman had become. And now she's an advocate to tell her truth.
Right.
On TikTok. But I want to go back to your question, because I had extremely strong feelings, over a particular public person. And I'm not going to say the name, what they do, what about it.
That's not important.
Yes, because it's not. But what is important is that I stopped, like I knew how I felt. I couldn't even look, or I'd hear the voice on TV and I would just like, ugh. I said, okay, this isn't good. And I would listen, actively listen to what was being said, read things that I would project badly, because you know, that's what our brains do. Project. Right. And I said, no, I'm going to give it a fair shot. And it softened my feelings. There are things that I agree with this person now, and there are things that I disagree. But I was so set up because of a couple of circumstances that I just threw the baby out with the bathwater, because I felt so strong about one particular thing. Honestly, that's it. That's challenging your strong feelings to not find confirming bias, which is what this woman did, but to openly look at disconfirming information and trying to be open and listen. It's what I call life intelligence, because emotional intelligence, great. I can label my emotions. I'm mad. I can, you know, use a couple of the words to label them. And I can recognize that you're mad. I mean, emotional intelligence still to me is it's a grand goal, but it's not definitively measured as to, you could say, who could say one is very emotionally intelligent or not. But I think the key to it is being able to step back and look at a situation dispassionately and to be able to listen.
So here's the thing that comes to mind.
Tell me what's on your mind.
The way that I do it, especially recently around the political environment that we're in, I ask myself the question, when I'm talking to somebody about politics, am I talking to a voter or am I talking to a supporter? Because they're two different types of people. The supporter has tendency to raise their candidate up as somebody that they worship, right? Somebody that they follow. They follow without question. They agree with everything they're saying. The world's coming to an end. The world's going to come to an end, right? Or am I dealing with a voter who has the intelligence to question, right? To question a decision that is being made and is okay in doing that. So I'm always asking myself those two questions. And I think the same kind of thought process is happening here. We tend to, or maybe it's easier to follow someone or worship something, and it's easier to follow and say that, well, he's a wonderful person or she's a wonderful person and everything they say is awesome and I believe in everything they're doing. It's easier to do that than it is to say, no, I'm going to critique her or critique him because what he said I don't agree with. And I'm not going to get the backlash because I'm not following him or following her. So there's a difference between voters and worshipers or supporters. And I think that has a lot to do with the way that a lot of us live our life, especially around that whole topic of jumping into something and believing it 100%, not giving yourself the time to critique it. Because if you critique it, then there's a possibility that what they're saying is wrong, and then you've just spent all this energy for no good reason.
Like this lady.
Like this lady.
And what a lot of groups, religions, it doesn't matter, the great way to gain followers is to create fear. And I really like Byron Katie's quote, where she says, fear has only two causes, the thought of losing what you have or the thought of not getting what you want. And it's true. That's why so many people fall into the fear trap. And what does fear do? It overrides your critical thinking skills. Cognitively, you don't have it. And if you want to call that, intelligence you mentioned earlier, I don't know if you're talking about emotional intelligence or just education, but your overriding fears hijack your ability to think cognitively well, unless you consciously set aside that fear and say, okay, I'm going to calm down, look at this rationally. But it takes effort. And you just have to understand that fear takes away your ability to think.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, too, I mean, I would venture to say and go out on a limb here and say that nobody, God nor man or woman, is worthy of blind praise and support. No one is. So if you are in a situation where you're just praising and supporting a cause because that's just what you're doing and you're not putting any thought into it, nobody's worthy of that much power.
And nobody. Groups too, right?
Groups, yeah, groups. Exactly. Yeah.
And if you look at what happens is that people defend a group. It could be a political party. It could be your union. It could be your religion. And they can't say out loud, I agree with them here, but I don't agree here. And this goes back to our all or nothing loyalty.
Right.
Or some of us are raised where you don't question, you don't, you just follow, you believe, and you don't know that you're not really thinking. You're just regurgitating.
Did you have an Italian mother? I did.
No. My mom was what did you that
I remember from the South. I remember the first time I had a vote, I said to my dad, I said, "Dad, this is the first time I'm voting. It was for Carter." And I said, "How do I do it?" He said, "You just go in, you go to the top, you hit D, and you walk out." And I was like, "What?" He said, "There's no other thing you need to do. Just go in and hit D and you're good." And I'm like, "Oh my gosh. Okay, well, we're not thinking here." But when you listen to that, we laugh about that. But how many people live by that, right? How many people just live by, you know, this blind praise? And whether, you know, again, no matter whether it's a group situation or a person or a movement, it, you know, there might be things in those groups or in those movements that you might agree with.
Absolutely.
But to just follow them blindly says more about you as an individual than it does about them as a leader.
Yeah, so I'm here as a reformed blind follower to say you can take those steps, and it feels uncomfortable. And I know that that woman was uncomfortable, and she's probably never going to let that happen to her again. Probably that's not. My guess. Yeah.
No, I don't think so either.
And I think that, and this is just my humble opinion from my experience, if you think that your all-abiding devotion to a group or to a person doesn't come with some recourse, I would question that. And I would recommend that people question things. And that is what critical thinking is. People who've never gone to college, this is typically where people learn the critical thinking skills, but it isn't just in college. It's something that we can acquire individually just by questioning things.
Questioning things and experiencing things.
Yep.
Right? I mean, my uncle was amazing with his hands. He could build and fix anything. And talk about a critical thinker. He had to be, right? Because he had to understand, if he makes a cut here, what effect is it going to have on the balance or on the support of this section of the house over here? So he never went to college, but he learned critical thinking through his hands, through working. He didn't just accept in life what was given to him. He questioned it. So you're right. College, you learn the critical thinking, but you also learn it in life. So yeah, you don't have to go to college, but that's not an excuse not to be a critical thinker.
No, you're right. And, you know? and the other thing that helps to expand how you think, because it's not just challenging those thoughts, but the expansion that you talked about, experiences, like being experiential, getting involved and learning about other cultures, mm-hmm. learning about other ways of life. You don't have to travel to do it. Coursera, there's all kinds of things. In fact, you know that group Mind Valley?
Yeah, absolutely.
The founder, I can't think of his name, but he is a huge promoter of lifelong learning. And that is really helpful and beneficial to broadening your viewpoints by giving you access to different points of view. And it's really, like I said, life intelligence.
Oh, it absolutely is. But just as a point of reference, I believe you're speaking about Vishen Lakhiani, who is currently teaching Mind Valley. So yes. I think we could go on for another hour and just talk about how this type of behavior, and I'm going to call it behavior because it is really this type of behavior or actions or belief, the kind of impact that it has on our values. You know, our values change over time, based on our experiences, right? Based on our critical thinking. And a lot of people will confuse values and morals, or they'll go hand to hand. And I do believe that they are two different things. Let's talk next week about how critical thinking impacts our values.
Yes. And the bigger point of all that is, can you change your mind?
Yes. Changing your mind. I like it.
Yeah.
I like it. Well, geez, Kim, that was good. I liked having that discussion with you today. That was cool.
I did too.
Yeah.
There's a lot. There's just so much to life, right? And the older I get, the more broad it is, and the more I want to take a bite out of all of it. And I can tell you from experience that broadening your horizons and challenging has just made such a huge difference for me emotionally.
Yeah, me as well. And I will give you an example of that before we end the show today. So the other day, someone asked me a religious question. They said, do you believe in Adam and Eve and the creation story, that they were the first two humans on earth? And I said, I believe that God creates through means of evolution, and through time, humans evolved. And they said, well, for lack of arguing, can you agree that Adam and Eve were the first two humans on earth? And I said, okay, Adam and Eve are the first two humans on earth. And then he said, can you agree that through Adam and Eve, the rest of humanity came into existence? And I said, all right, keep going. And he said, great. Now, Adam and Eve had Cain and Abel, right? I said, okay, Adam and Eve had Cain and Abel. And they said, and Cain and Abel had children, right? And I said, hold up. And they said, what? And I said, if Adam and Eve had Cain and Abel, where were the women in order for Cain and Abel to have children? And they looked at me and they said, huh? And I said, well, Cain and Abel needed women in order to produce another child, right? And they said, yeah. And I said, that's critical thinking. Think about what people are asking you instead of just accepting it as gospel, right?
That's right. So when someone asks, what color was George Washington's white horse? You know the answer.
That's exactly right.
Guess what you have to do? You have to listen.
That's right.
Thank you, John.
All right, Kim. Thank you. Everyone, have a great day. Thanks for listening. Kim, enjoy the rest of your week.
You too. Bye.
All righty. Bye-bye. Shows are available every Saturday right here on HeartMind-ify.podbean.com or wherever you listen. Kim and I would like to thank each and every one of you for allowing us to be a small part of your life. Be kind to yourself and remember, our hearts tell the story, but our mind is the conductor.